Let's move on to the second process. The physics of this process is we already covered, the physics of arc, physics of rest and seating. Okay, so they are all done. So we'll just quickly look at the process characteristics of all these things. So the second is the magnetically impelled arc butt welding. Okay, and in this case, we don't use any filler. Okay, so we strike an arc between the two interfacing interfaces, same as in flash butt welding. Right, but in flash butt welding, when you are doing welding, when you strike an arc, the characteristic of the electron path, the electron would always try to travel at the surface, least resistance path. So when you strike an arc, say for example in a two material, okay, so the arc will be struck only from the surface because that is the path the electrons would always take, isn't it? So then, if you are welding it for a say pipe configuration. And circular configuration, and you have two pipes, you want to strike an arc. Arc would always be struck at the surface, the ID and OD of the pipes, inner diameter and outer diameter, surface of the pipes. Suppose if you want to use the arc as a heat source, and you strike an arc only at the top and bottom surface of the pipe, and you are not going to melt the entire cross section thickness, isn't it? So we will have to find a way to manipulate the arc, or you need to strike an arc through entire cross section, but that is not physically possible because the electron would always travel at the surface, isn't it? So how do you make sure that the arc is struck or arc is traveled throughout the cross section of the thickness, right? So we have some tricks because this arc can be deflected by magnetic field, isn't it? Right? So by attaching a very strong magnets surrounding the weld job, in this case for example pipes, and this arc can be impelled or can be deflected throughout the cross section, and they can also be made rotated throughout the circumference of the pipe using a strong magnet surrounding the pipe. So otherwise you would never heat the entire cross section of the pipe, isn't it, the thickness of the pipe, because when you strike an arc, and for flash butt welding it is okay because the thicknesses what we use are very small, flash butt 2 mm, 3 mm, but if you want to weld a 20 mm wall thickness pipe, and you will have a strong temperature gradient because the arc will be struck only at the surface, so the center thickness will never melt, right, so the heat may not be conducted, and if you want to melt then you will have to keep it for longer time. Okay, then productivity is lost, isn't it? So then you will have to strike more current, more energy you will have to spend. So in a way, so if you attach a magnet surrounding the arc, see the arc can be impelled, so not only through thickness but also impelled along the circumference, isn't it? So otherwise you will never strike an arc throughout the cross section because with the electrons if they pass, it will pass where it finds the least resistance, isn't it? So it will go only at the surface, inner and outer thicknesses, the surface, and it will not go entire cross section, okay? It will travel at varying distances, varying positions. So by attaching a very strong magnet surrounding the pipe, so we can impel the arc throughout the cross section and through the thickness. So you can melt much more uniformly by using the magnets, right? And these magnets would impel the arc along the circumference as well as along the thicknesses so that we can melt, and moment you melt you will have a upsetting, okay? So upsetting is very important because the molten material, molten liquid would also contaminate from the atmosphere, it will form oxides, okay? Inclusion will form, and we do not want that in the weld. Okay, so what do we do then? Then the same as in flash butt weld, we will do a flashing or upsetting to expel the liquid metal. We will have a mechanical coalescence of the heat affected zone, which is actually next to the molten the surface. Coalesce, it will form the weld. Right? It's clear. It's same as a flash butt. So what do you do in flash bed? We strike an arc, we maintain some gap, strike an arc, we melt, and then we do an upsetting. So the molten material would go as a flash, and then the solid regions would mechanically deform and coalesce, form a joint. The same as over here. So only problem here is we can achieve the large thick cross section wells by making sure that arc is impelled through the cross section and through the cross thickness, right? And then later the upset material can be removed off, right? And we are going to get this equipment in a month's time. Welding is done, and this process creates a huge noise, because you can see the arc is, when it is impelled, it makes a huge noise. I have a video for that as well. So we fix a camera inside the pipe. Okay, you can look at, you can appreciate the load of magnets. Okay, so nothing is moving, only arc is moving. Okay, so what you see over here is the, okay. So you see that, and so the entire circumference and thickness is arced, because we have a magnetic field of about 3 Tesla. Okay, and that magnetic field is deflecting and impelling the arc through the cross sections as well as along the thickness. Okay, otherwise you would never achieve such a arcing in along all the cross sections. Okay, so it will be somewhere here and somewhere over there, only at the surface. Yeah, now upset. That's it. Okay, so upset is done at the last stages. So now it is moving towards each other. So the preset gap is maintained to strike an arc, and then you make the magnet work, so that the arc is impelled along the circumference as well as through thickness. You melt enough volume, you heat up enough material, and then you bring both the interfaces together with a very high speed upsetting. You can ripple, you can impel the liquid metal out as a flash, and then the heated up the solid regions can coalesce, make the joint. Okay, that's it. So it will be fantastic. I mean, I don't have an high speed video of this process, but I have seen an high speed video. But we'll record it once the equipment is there. But you can see the arc, the impellent, the frequency is extremely high. You see that? So what you see over here, we fix the camera inside the pipe. Okay, so this is the interface from the one side. Right? Okay, good. Is clear the process? And yeah,
while offsetting,
yeah,
fibers can come even inside the pipe.
Inside the pipe, we generally leave it. Okay, so the machining is done. So only outside. That's a good point. So for the gas pipelines, so we'll have to remove the flash even from the inside as well. So then now we have a robotic heads with the machining. It will travel inside the pipe and then machine it off. Okay, so that is possible. So otherwise, if it is not like used for high pressure the transportation, you can leave the pipes. It's not a problem. For gas pipeline, it's not a problem. For fluids, so you'll have to remove the inner flash, and that is machined off, because within a moving machining head inside the pipe. That's done, commonly done. Okay, so this process is clear. The trick is use a magnet. Okay, it's very high power magnet we use, and the equipment which we buy, it has a permanent magnet. Okay, so permanent magnet, it is attached with the clamp. So the clamp which is actually going to hold, it also has a magnet. Okay, so and the magnetic clamps is going to be attached. Okay, and then the material which is going to weld need not be magnetic. Okay, so we can use non-magnetic material also, because the arc is electromagnetic and it's going to be reflected, impelled by the magnetic force. Right? It's clear? Good. It is also known as rotating arc welding because arc is rotated. Okay. But most commonly used terminology is MIAB, so magnetically impelled arc butt welding, MIAB. Okay. So what are the advantages? Again, so the MIAB is very nice process to weld pipelines of a very high thickness. Okay. And so the final joint does not have any solidified structure, is not it, because liquid is expelled. So you have a deformation. So finally when the weld joint after removal of flash, it does not have any segregation, is not it. So all the problem that are associated with solidified microstructure, it is not there. The pipe will have a mechanically deformed interface. Okay, so that will be recrystallized, will have much finer grind size. Okay, so that is why you know this process is very widely can be used for welding pipelines for high temperature applications. Okay, the arc is the heat source, it melts. Okay, and then the arc expelled and then impelled along the circumference thickness to heat the material, and subsequently all the molten material is expelled by the upsetting. And then we have a solid bonding, okay, solid state bonding or welding of the interface. Okay, so technically it is a solid state process, same as a flash butt, right? But we still melt, okay, and we don't need to rotate the component, okay, or the weld. Suppose if you are using conventional GMAW, you will have to weld in 5G configuration. That means that the welding heat source would be going around the pipe, or pipe has to be rotated. Is not necessary here in this case, right? Because the arc is made rotate, okay, and then we can achieve the welding in very short time, 2 to 4 seconds. Yes, it's clear. Good. So we'll see one more, and then we'll wind up. Okay, the last, the liquid metal process. What we are going to look at is the aluminothermic welding, and aluminothermic welding. It is very commonly used. To weld rails, okay. So rails, and I don't know how many of you have seen thermit welding in a railway station. So when you are, in most of the cases, when the welding is done in railway lines, you would see 10, 12 engineers standing. One guy would be welding. So these 10, 12 engineers will make sure that welding is done properly. The guy who is actually there in welding, he would be working extremely hard, right? So because these 12 guys are the responsible for the quality of the weld. Okay, so if you go to my YouTube page, so there are 3 videos of thermit welding. So railways are lines are welded in field by thermit welding. Okay, so thermit welding works in the principle that. So when the oxides of the metals react with aluminium and they burn, okay, you generate aluminium oxide and enormous amount of heat by exothermic reaction of oxidation of aluminium. Okay, so that is the heat source, and then the metal oxide will be reduced and you form a molten metal. Okay, it's a simple principle, right? So do have a look at my YouTube page. I have 3 videos. So how we do is, so this is a railway welding. So railway, you see that rail is there. Okay, so you make a mold. It is a casting process, okay, in a way. Okay, and then you fill with the thermit and then iron oxide mixer, and then igniter burns, and then the reaction happens. So what is the reaction? So if you have an iron oxide plus aluminium, right? L2O3, Fe, and then you generate heat because the reaction is exothermic. Okay, during this process, the iron which is actually produced from the reaction melts, okay, fills the weld cavity, isn't it, right? And you also generate molten liquid. By the filling the thermit mixture, which is a mixture of metal oxide and aluminium, you ignite, and then you contain the resultant molten liquid by the mold. Okay, and then this liquid metal penetrates to the weld cavity and then solidifies at the weld cavity, and then subsequently you can machine off the excess material, a riser, and then the joint will be made after subsequently made. Okay. So you can, this is my YouTube page. So you can look at it, and there are three videos which actually very long videos, you know, you can enjoy, you know, from the beginning, right. So it is very clear, right. So the main principal reaction what you use is the exothermic reaction. When the metal oxide reacts with aluminium and it burns, it forms aluminium oxide and liquid metal, and the amount of heat you generate and can be very high, right. For example, the first reaction, so Fe3O4 reacts with aluminium, forms liquid iron, aluminium oxide. The enthalpy of this reaction is 832 kilojoules per mole of oxide. Okay, so that is a huge heat, and this heat actually produces molten iron. Okay, so you can also use FeO, and also you can also weld copper as well. So the delta H of the reaction is even higher, right? It's clear. Okay, so we'll look at it again next class. I'll try to bring these videos. Okay, but it's a really long video, but we'll see. And then so then you can appreciate, because almost the entire railway lines in the field, even in India, it's done with thermit welding. Okay, so it's a very effective, very simple process, very clean process. Okay, but it's very old. Okay, so nowadays we are also developing technology to weld railways using flash butt, but flash butt cannot be done in field. Okay, you have to do an offsetting as well, right? So flash butt, trying to get into railways. Also, we are also trying to develop laser hybrid to join two rails, but those are far fetched ideas. So right now, railway lines in the field, they are all welded with thermit welding. Okay, so we'll see the video next class.